So I'm sitting on a park bench in the North End one day, and these tourists from the Midwest come walking by, and they point to the statue of Tony DeMarco, and they said, "Who's that guy?" I said, "Who's that guy?" Boxing legend Tony DeMarco. When he first stepped into the ring as a professional in 1948, he was a 16-year-old kid boxing under the borrowed name of Tony DeMarco, because he wasn't old enough to box under his own name, Leonardo Liotta. When he stepped into the ring for his first big payday against Paddy DeMarco, he became known as the Boston Bomber. When he was lifted up in the ring at the Boston Garden in 1955 as the new world champion after defeating Johnny Saxton in a brutal 14th round finish, he was known as the Flame and the Fury of Fleet Street. Now, after a life spent staring down mob bosses and rubbing elbows with the likes of Ali, Sinatra, and Jack Ruby, a life filled with unimaginable victories and truly unimaginable losses, a life that took him from the back streets of a post-war ethnic neighborhood in Boston to find fame, weather tragedy, and win the enduring love of one of the country's greatest cities. Now, when he walks the streets of the North End in Boston, he's known as our champ, and more importantly, our friend. This is the story of Tony DeMarco, the Flame and the Fury of Fleet Street. The former undisputed welterweight champion of the world. A cobbler's son who won his boxing championship title only a few blocks from the house where he was born. This is the story of a boxing icon whose epic battles with the legendary Carmen Basilio are considered two of the greatest fights of the 20th century. Young Leonardo, nicknamed NARDO, grew up in the heart of Boston's Italian section, the North End. A neighborhood rich in American history. As a matter of fact, Paul Revere's home, which still stands, is just steps from NARDO's front door and just a few steps from the old North Church that launched Revere's famous ride. By the time NARDO's family moved to the North End, it had evolved into Boston's Little Italy, with immigrants from all over mainland Italy and Sicily settling there. Say that 10 times fast. NARDO's parents, Vincenzo and Giacomino Liotta, were hard-working Sicilian immigrants trying to fulfill the promise of the American dream. They lived on Fleet Street, in the shadow of the famed Boston Garden, close enough to hear the cheers and the murmurs of the crowds coming and going before and after sports history was written on the garden floor. But I don't think NARDO's father ever thought that his young son would sell out the garden more than any other human in its history. And his mother never dared to dream that the garden cheers would one day be for her young boy. NARDO's love for boxing started when he joined the Boston Boys Club boxing team. It became immediately evident that he had a special talent as a puncher. He was also fearless and unflinching, often defeating boys 2 and 3 years older than himself. NARDO quickly established a reputation as the little kid with the big punch. He wanted to join the amateur ranks when he was 15, but while he could defeat older boxers, there was no punch that could tame the problem of his age. He was 3 years younger than he needed to be to get his boxing license. Always enterprising, NARDO convinced a boyhood friend, Tony Lobo DeMarco, who was 18 years old, to let him borrow his name. Lobo went to the local priest and asked him for a copy of his baptismal certificate to use as proof of age so he could get a job. The priest was happy to oblige, not knowing that Lobo would promptly hand over the certificate to NARDO to use as proof of age for his boxing license. A short year later, after turning pro at age 16, Tony DeMarco established himself as a relentless puncher and quickly rose to the pro ranks, leaving an impressive trail of knockouts. Tony's pro career began on October 21, 1948, when he KO'd Media Jones in the first round. He then began to work his way up the ladder, beating opponents such as Vic Young, Bobby Weaver, Manny Santos, and Pug Brown. Over the first 2 years of his career, he jumped out to a 10-1 record, knocking out 8 opponents. It didn't take long for Tony to attract some of the highest caliber support in Boston's rich boxing community. He worked with the great Sammy Fuller as his trainer, along with Coogie McFarland, and Bobby Agrippino. And Tony would soon catch the eye of Rip Valenti, a powerful and connected manager. The stakes of the game rose quickly as Tony fought more seasoned boxers like Pat Demers, Chick Boucher, and Teddy Redtop Davis. Tony's devastating punching power became his calling card, and his impressive 30-3 record was starting to turn heads outside of New England. Tony gained national recognition by beating the likes of lightweight champion Paddy DeMarco, Wilbur Wilson, contender George Arujo, and the great lightweight champ Jimmy Carter. It was just a matter of time before Tony would get his shot at the crown. You need to understand something. After punching his way to the number two ranking of the welterweight division, Tony got his chance in early 1955 when he signed to take on defending champion Johnny Saxton for the undisputed welterweight championship of the world. The fight was scheduled to take place on April 1st, 1955 at the Boston Garden, just steps from Tony's boyhood home. The city of Boston pulsated with the possibility that one of its favorite sons, one of their own, could win a major championship and could win it in his own backyard. As fight night approached, the story of an Italian kid growing up in the north end of Boston, having now become an iconic story of a boy rising from the street to stand one step away from the top of the mountain, had captured the imagination of the whole country. A young 23-year-old Italian kid from the neighborhood was taking on the champ. Imagine that. But the champ was facing much more than a hungry and dangerous challenger that night. He was fighting a city. As it turned out, however, the kid from the neighborhood was all that was needed.
Johnny Saxton, the champion, defends his title against Tony DeMarco in Boston Garden. Saxton to the right of your screen, DeMarco to the left.
All right, so the fight started fast and furious with both fighters trading blows and flurries.
I had a crack in the lens, but the action was so spectacular that we didn't want knockout fans to miss it. Saxton won his championship 5 months ago from Kid Gavilan. DeMarco, number one challenger and a terrific puncher, has scored 28 knockouts. Now in round four, the action is furious with DeMarco staying right in there. Saxton has the reach over DeMarco, but this doesn't seem to bother DeMarco, who is fiercely determined.
In the 14th round, Tony decked Saxton, and the complexion of the fight changed dramatically.
DeMarco is in full control. He punches from all angles, never allowing Saxton to get an attack underway. The champion, Johnny Saxton, refuses to go down. A true champion goes out this way, but we don't know what's keeping him up. It appears to be just a question of time before DeMarco ends it. Finally puts the champion down.
Tony hits Saxton with 24 consecutive punches. Think about that.
Saxton gets up, only to be met by swarms of DeMarco punches thrown from all angles in a wild demonstration of fighting fury. DeMarco relentlessly hits Saxton with every punch in the book. The champion is completely helpless. Saxton is taking too much punishment, unable to defend himself, and the referee stops the fight. There's a wild scene as Tony DeMarco wins the welterweight championship of the world from a courageous Johnny Saxton.
The crowd at the Garden erupted, igniting a celebration in the streets of the city, the state, and especially the North End that would last for days. Tony was the champion of the world. The champion of the world! The cobbler's son was now forever a world champion. And NARDO would forever be Tony DeMarco. Fame and celebrity would soon follow. The kid from the North End now rubbed elbows with the biggest and brightest stars of the day. He moved his training camp to the Catskills, where he befriended the great heavyweight champ from Brockton, Mass., Rocky Marciano. The two Italian neighborhood kids formed strong and lasting bonds, remaining friends until Rocky's untimely death. Just 3 months later, Tony defended his title against the onion farmer from New York, Carmen Basilio.
Syracuse, June 10th, 1955. DeMarco has just won the welterweight title, and here they have him defending it in Basilio's hometown. DeMarco in black trunks. See how Basilio paused with that left, then he drops it to his side. That's a come on. Let Tony stick his face in there and bang. Carmen will sure hook him fast.
Any short list of the greatest fights of all time will tell the tale of this fight right here. Tony and Carmen battered each other for 12 furious rounds.
Basilio is just picking off punches, picking his spots. Tony's hurt. Watch him, Kessler. This is a nice kid. Let's not get him hurt. That's right.
Tony lost to Basilio on cuts in the 12th round. It was a decision, of course, but such an end to such a fight was less than satisfying. Nothing was truly settled. Undoubtedly, the wheels had started turning on a rematch even before the results of the first fight had hit the street. The DeMarco versus Basilio 2 began with 8 brutal rounds, in which momentum shifted sides with the force of loose cargo in the hull of a storm-ravaged freighter. Tony had Carmen on the ropes in the 7th round, staggering him with a left hook that would have dropped a lesser opponent and ended a lesser fight.
Seconds to go in the 7th round, and a striking left hook, and Carmen Basilio's knees are of rubber. DeMarco trying to put across the big one. Carmen Basilio fighting on instinct, has wobbly legs. He backs away from the rushing Tony DeMarco. DeMarco can't get the punch into the head that counts. There's the bell.
Basilio retained the welterweight championship by knocking out Tony at 154 in the 12th round. This fight was voted the fight of the decade and is still considered one of the top 10 greatest fights of all time. Tony went on to fight a total of 8 world champions over his great and lucrative career, although he never regained the championship. In 1956, Tony fought Bud Smith, Kid Gavilan, and Gaspar Ortega. That year, Tony also fought Vince Martinez at historic Fenway Park, a fight that was preceded by a meeting in the runway between Tony and his Fenway counterpart, Ted Williams. Although he fought in many venues, Tony was a favorite at the Garden. He holds the record for the most fights and most sellouts in Boston Garden history.
DeMarco wants a crack at Johnny Saxton's welterweight crown, and he's trying to end it right here. And you can see why DeMarco is the most feared puncher in the welterweight division. Now against the ropes, the gallant Danish middleweight Chris Christensen seems almost unable to defend himself. It's DeMarco with a tremendous left and sharp right, and Christensen is down.
Tony's circle of friends expanded to include people from all walks of life. Celebrities, sports personalities, and politicians. His very successful nightclub in Phoenix, Arizona, attracted many entertainers and celebrities. But his boyhood neighborhood chums are the friends he is closest to, even to this day. This close-knit group had a lot of fun, wreaked a lot of havoc, and wrote a lot of North End history. But perhaps, most importantly, they always looked out for each other in good times and in bad. Among the moments of triumph in his professional life, there were also moments of tragedy that forever shaped his personal life. Tony lost a brother, a son, and a daughter, all at very young ages. Those losses tempered the victories, balancing Tony's appreciation of what is gained and what is lost along the way. Today, Tony DeMarco is still very active in the community and in the boxing world. He attends many charity events, mentors young boxers, and is one of the sport's greatest supporters. Tony is the unofficial ambassador of Boston's North End, chatting with tourists like yourselves and helping out the local businesses. He is president emeritus, whatever that means, of the Massachusetts chapter of the Italian American Sports Hall of Fame, as well as a regular cast member in the long-running comedy Joey and Maria's Wedding. In recognition of an accomplished son, the city of Boston renamed the upper end of Fleet Street in the North End to Tony DeMarco Way. He was honored with this statue, where he won his world championship and where his boyhood home still stands right here in the North End. NARDO. Tony DeMarco. The Boston Bomber. The Flame and the Fury of Fleet Street. The Champ. Fiercely proud of both his boxing heritage and his Italian heritage alike, Tony DeMarco is a true Boston icon, and he's my hero.